All right, I got the doggies here, and really killed my white balance there. All right, so this video is going to be all about the five most exciting upgrades to your home theater. And these are my personal five favorite upgrades. The most exciting upgrades, the upgrades where I did it and I was just like, wow, this really worked out. I'm glad I did that. Unfortunately, it doesn't happen with every upgrade we do, right? Like we'll do something, we'll get something better. And at first we'll be like, yeah, that was awesome. And then we're like, well, maybe it wasn't that awesome. And you know, you want to be excited about it, but you're not. And that happens. And for number five, that definitely happens. And number five is better speakers, okay? Better speakers is one of those things that is usually good. Now, there are times when it doesn't work out, where you get speakers that are, they have a great brand name, they've got a great reputation, and you get them out and you plug them in and you end up lying to yourself at first. You're like, oh yeah, this sounds better, but as time goes by, it doesn't really agree with you. And that's the thing with speakers, is it's more of a personal flavor thing. With subwoofers, for me, I can, you know, I've got the list of subwoofers that I recommend to pretty much anybody, because it's not so much a taste thing. It's, I mean, it is, but it's more of a hard numbers kind of thing. It's more of a, is not so much nuance, right? Whereas with speakers, some people might like a little bit brighter of a tone, a little bit more of a warm tone. You know, it's much more subjective. So with speakers, it can really be, it can run the gamut. And so, and the frustrating thing about speakers is you can hear very expensive speakers and be turned off. It's happened with me. I've gone to, you know, stores, I'm not gonna mention their names, but I'll hear some $500 speakers, $1,000 speakers, $25,000 speakers. And I've had it where the $25,000 speakers, I could have picked 10 other speakers in the store I would have rather had that were all under $1,000 that I preferred. It's all a matter of taste, and it's a matter of it's subjective to your personal taste. And so, you know, that's just one of those things that you can run into. You can go and get a great pair of speakers and be, you know, or I should rephrase that. You can go out and get a really expensive pair of speakers and really be disenchanted with it. So that's one of those things that's, it's a maybe. But when you get better speakers, and they really are better speakers and they sound great, that really is an exciting upgrade. Number four is Dolby Atmos. And this is gonna be kind of a controversial one. I had a viewer comment the other day about, oh, Dolby Atmos is terrible, they cut the frequency off. Yeah. And I'm like, I don't think he's actually heard it. And the reason I say that is because you can get all the equipment and put it all together and still not get true Dolby Atmos signal because your Blu-ray player won't allow it. So you can check out the Bass Hacks Dolby Atmos hack for more on that. But once you get it all dialed in and get it all working, and you put in a Blu-ray that has Dolby Atmos, and you actually hear the Atmos on a good movie, and that's another thing too. There are certain movies that just aren't as exciting. The Last Jedi, for instance, the Dolby Atmos mix wasn't that exciting, whereas, Bram Stoker's Dracula was really good. So that's kind of, that's one of those, you kind of go back and forth things. But for like Roger Waters' The Wall, amazing. So Dolby Atmos is my number four. When I got that working and I got it all actually functioning and sounding good, wow, that's a lot of fun. It's a lot more immersive than I would have expected. When I first plugged it in, it wasn't all that exciting, but then when I got it actually working, it was amazing. So that was a really exciting upgrade. It's been continuously fun. It's rare that I get an Atmos movie and I'm not excited about it, because usually, you know, it's not just having the sound overhead, it's the ability to really put the sound in between the speakers. They do a great job at that. And I really like it. And the same, you know, DTS:X movies, same type of thing. It does really well. So, you know, that's my number four. Number three is your display. So I'm gonna say most of the time, usually this works out. There's a few times where you'll get a new display, whether it be a TV or a projector, and it may not live up to your standards. That happens, okay? But usually, 9 times out of 10, you're going bigger. You're going up in resolution. You know, perhaps you're going from a 1080p to a Dolby Vision TV. You know, that kind of thing. That's exciting. That's fun, and it's almost universally good. There are a few times where you can go backwards, but that's one of those times when it's usually pretty good. Number two is upgrading your AVR. Now, this is, again, this can go both ways, because if you get something with a certain expectation and doesn't live up to it, it can be a problem. But generally speaking, for me, I went from a home theater in a box type AVR to my X2000. And when I finally got that all dialed in and did the room correction and all that, it sounded a lot better over the previous AVR that I had. And then when I decided I wanted to go with Atmos and, you know, do the overhead thing, my X2000 wouldn't cover it. So I moved to the Denon X6200. And that was a dramatic upgrade, because I had 9 channels instead of 7, and I had Atmos and all that. And so it was really good. Probably something that I would look out for if you're doing the upgrade is to look for something like Odyssey XT32. The Denon 2000 series, which now they have like the 2400, maybe we're getting into the 2500 series, but the 2000 series has the lower room correction. So it's just Odyssey XT. The XT32 is a pretty dramatic upgrade. And it's funny that the room correction, set there really makes that big of a difference, but it does. I know, because I've gone back and forth from the X2000 to the 6200, and the difference is really good. So I would really look for XT32. Now, of course, I've heard good things about Anthem. I haven't actually heard it myself, but Anthem has good AVRs as well. But that's one of those things, when you move up into the higher end and you get into the Odyssey XT32, which is found in Denon and Marantz and a few other brands, I think, but it really does make a difference. They do a good job. I still have to go in and make adjustments afterwards and things like that. And I've gone over that, things like that, in my other videos, and I'll put links to that down in the description below. But that's one of those things that really shows up. So that's my number two. My number one, most exciting upgrade I've ever made to my home theater, and this shouldn't come as a massive surprise, but deep bass subwoofers and in duals. So when I first moved to a deep bass subwoofer, it was a single, and it sounded really good, sounded way better than any other sub I've heard prior to that point. And I have had dual subs, but they were way mismatched and it wasn't that exciting. But I have done dual subs before. And so I had this bigger single sub, it sounded good. It was much better than anything I'd previously heard. And it was exciting, because where previous subs would flutter and falter and fart and do all this stuff, the sub handled it. It took the stuff that was really challenging for most other subs and it handled it with ease, okay? And then so going from that to a dual deep bass sub was extraordinary. I was able to hear everything in terms of bass. You have room modes and things like that, and nodes and loud spots and dead spots with a single, and you get much less of that with the duals. So I was really able to hear all of the bass that I didn't realize I was missing. And it's one of those things where people say, well, are dual subs really necessary? In my opinion, no, only if you really want good bass. So, yeah, if you want good bass, I think they're necessary. And I think going with dual subs, matching is a good way to go. Anytime I've tried to mix and match, I'm not saying it's impossible. I'm just saying it seems to come out cleaner and a little more well put together when they're dual matching subs. I like ported. I've got my list of subwoofers on the website that I would actually buy myself. I would actually spend my own money. You'll find they're all ported subs. I'm not wild about sealed subs. I prefer the ported versions. They give you more of that impact. They're more comfortable to listen to all day. But for me, that was my most exciting upgrade, was going with dual ported subwoofers that are able to hit down to 20 hertz and have you actually hear it. Because there are subs that go down to, they're rated down to 19 hertz, 17 hertz, but they're really not loud there. They're not, it's not powerful at that lower volume. Most subs, they get quieter as they go deeper. So that combination of having dual subs and dual deep subwoofers was the most exciting upgrade I've ever done to the home theater, because the power and the impact that you get from these movies is amazing. And yet at the same time, you listen to music and it's quiet and delicate when it's supposed to be, but then you put on like West Coast rap and it's just thundering and powerful and it's and all clean. Like you're hearing it the way it's supposed to be heard, not, you know, most people are used to hearing distortion and they think of distortion as bass, but they're hearing distortion. When you actually hear good, clean bass, you have to go through and listen to everything again, because everything you've heard up to that point has been distorted and kind of funky. When you hear the deep bass versions and you hear it with dual subs, it's like it's a whole different experience. And you know, you hear the term rediscovering old music, and it's absolutely. I listen mostly to music on this. I listen to a lot of, I watch a lot of movies and stuff, but music is most important to me. And being able to go through and hear things that I've heard in the past, and it's just like, wow, I didn't know that was there. I didn't know that was the actual sound I was supposed to hear. What I had heard in the past was either not much at all, or you know, chuffing and all kinds of stuff. So for me, bar none, again, it shouldn't be a surprise. I'm all about bass, I'm all about subwoofers. Deep bass subwoofers were the most exciting upgrade, bar none. It's not even close. Everything else is icing on the cake on this list. Going to deep bass subs really transformed the theater into something that was truly exciting and truly fun to listen to. So anyway, that's my list. If you've got different ideas on things that you found more exciting, what upgrades did you do that really were exciting to you? You got it plugged in, it was going, it was just like, wow, I am glad I did this. That's what I want to know from you. I'm curious to get feedback and see what you think on this. But anyway, I'm having fun with this channel. If you haven't subscribed, please do so. Stay tuned. I've got some things coming up. I've got some gear coming in that I'm kind of excited about, looking forward to checking out. So again, stay tuned and please subscribe.